بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاه أما بعد. This is our first lesson going through the poem الأرجوزة المئية في ذكر حال أشرف البرية صلى الله عليه وسلم authored by Ibn Abi Rizz الحنفي. This is a 100 line poem going through the prophetic seerah صلى الله عليه وسلم. And as we know, studying the seerah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is something very very important, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ اللَّهَ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرِ. That for the one who is in need and hope of the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the last day, then he needs to take the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as his role model. And you cannot take somebody as your role model unless you know who they are, what life they lived. And so this is the importance of studying the seerah. And also the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, لَا يَمِنُوا أَحَدُكُمْ حَتَّى أَكُونَ أَحَبَّ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ وَالِدِهِ وَالَدِهِ وَالنَّاسِ أَجْمَعِينَ. That indeed none of you will truly believe until he loves me more than he loves his own self, and he loves his own children, loves his own wives, and he loves his own parents. And so in order for someone to be able to love the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the way that he should be loved, then he needs to come, and he needs to have an understanding of the life of the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in order to gain and attain that love. And the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ has been documented from the early generations up until today. Ibn Ishaq, Ibn Hisham, غيرهم من أهل العلم who spent their time, spent their lives documenting the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ. Of course, throughout the books of hadith, you find, in fact, the books of hadith itself is a documentation of the life of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from beginning to the end, alayhi salatu wassalam. And some of the ulama rahimahumullah ta'ala wrote it in prose form. Another ulama rahimahumullah ta'ala, like Ibn Abi al-Izz al-Hanafi rahimahullah, he wrote it in a poem. So he turned the life of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he put it into 100 lines, summarizing it, as you'll see bi-idhin Allah ta'ala, where he says, وَهَاكَ, as we'll see bi-idhin Allah ta'ala, he said rahimahullah ta'ala, وَبَعْدُ هَاكَ سِيَرَةَ الرَّسُولِ مَنْظُومَةً مُجَزَةَ الْفُصُولِ. We'll see bi-idhin Allah ta'ala, the second line, that he wrote this poem in 100 lines. Al-Rujuz al-Mi'iyya, al-Mi'iyya refers to 100 lines of poetry that summarizes into succinct sections the life of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So let's begin with what the Musannif rahimahullah ta'ala says.
الحمد لله القدير الباري ثم صلاته على المختار وبعدها كسيرة الرسول منظومة مجازة الفصول مولده في عاشر الفضيل ربيعين الأول عام الفيل لكنما المشهور ثاني عشره في يوم الاثنين طلوع فجره ووافق العشرين من نيسان وقبله حين أبيه حانا.
So we're going to take these five lines بإذن الله تعالى today. The first line, the Musannif rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, Alhamdulillah al-Qadir al-Bari, thumma salatuhu ala al-Mukhtari. Alhamdulillah, all praise due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, al-Qadir al-Bari. And the Musannif ibn Abi al-Izz, he said, al-Qadim al-Bari, with the meme. And the author, and the one who's reading the Nazim here, who's reciting, he said, al-Qadiri. And the reason why it's al-Qadimi is not from the names of Allah Azza wa Jal. Although al-Qadim, it means al-Awwal alladhi laysa qablahu shay', the first, whom there is no one before. Of course, that is a meaning which is sahih, but is not a name from the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whereas Al-Qadir is from the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Bari refers to the maker, the one who awjada al-ashya' min al-adam, the one who created everything from nothing. It did not exist, and he brought it into existence. And Al-Khaliqu lil-makhluqat, the creator of the heavens and the earth, and the creator of all the creation. Wal-mubdi'u lil-kainat alayhi. Subhanahu wa ta'ala, Jalla Jalala. So he sends praise upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then salutation upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Thumma salatuhu ala al-mukhtar. And of course, you're meant to bring the salah and the salam together. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. But of course, due to the poetry, it's difficult to put them in together. And you find in many poems, or in many introductions, that sometimes you find the salam missing and just the salah being mentioned. And that they expect you to put the salam with the salah, that you should intrinsically know that. But due to the poem being the way in which it is, very difficult to write a poem, it was difficult to place a salam in there. So you just kept to the Salah. And as we know, the Salah is Thanaullah lahu fi mala'il a'la, as Abu al-Ari al-Rayahi rahimahullah ta'ala mentioned in Sahih al-Bukhari, reported Sahih al-Bukhari, mu'allaqan bi sighat al-jazm, Salatullahi Thanaullah alayhi fi mala'il a'la, aw 'inda al-mala'ika, wa salatu al-mala'ikati ad-du'a. فنسأل الله تبارك وتعالى أن يصلي ويسلم على النبي الأمي محمد بن عبد الله صلى الله عليه وسلم المختار المصطفى المختار رضي الله سبحانه وتعالى. سيد الله يصطفي من الملائكة رسلا ومن الناس. And of course the greatest messenger ever chosen was the messenger محمد بن عبد الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, one whose story we want to, the one whose seerah we want to learn in these sits بإذن الله تعالى. طيب, then the مصنف رحمه الله تعالى, he goes on to speaking about in the second line what this poem is about, what this work is concerning. وبعد هاك, this is to proceed كلمة انتقال after sending حمد ثناء upon Allah and sending salutation of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. I say هاك سيرة الرسول, this is خذ, take this سيرة of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, the life and سيرة, the prophetic life of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. And السيرة linguistically means الطريقة, it means the path, the good path that you should follow. طيب, and so of course with us, we are being told and being commanded to follow the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم and his path, which is the most honorable, the most beautiful path that anybody can traverse and try and gain benefits from. And of course, studying the seerah gives a person a holistic understanding of the state in which the Sharia was revealed. The state in which the Sharia was revealed. So when you're studying fiqh, when you're studying hadith, when you're studying all these concepts, knowing the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ will aid you a lot in having a greater understanding in those concepts, especially understanding fiqh al-nawazil, issues in fiqh that pertain to today. When you understand the state of the Prophet ﷺ back in that day and the state of the companions back in those days and relating it to our times, this is something which is very important. That's why the seerah is one of the core aspects that a person should study. خاتم النبيين, سيرة خاتم النبيين وإمام المرسلين صلى الله عليه وسلم. منظومة, so he wrote this as in poem form. موجازة الفصول, and I've done it in succinct sections, I've done it in summary, I've summarized all of the main aspects of the seerah in these 100 lines of poetry. Then the مصنف رحمه الله تعالى, he says مولده في عاشر الفضيل ربيع الأول عام الفيل لكنما المشهور ثاني عشره في يوم الاثنين طلوع فجره. He then goes on to mention the birth of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And so the date when the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam came into this earth alayhi salatu wasallam, and that was on the 10th of Rabi' al-Awwal al-Fadil, Ashir al-Fadil, the 10th of Rabi' al-Awwal. Rabi' al-Awwal is one of the months of the year. Muharram, Safar, Rabi' al-Awwal, the third month of the year. عام الفيل, the year of the elephant. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said in the Quran, أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ فَعَلَ رَبُّكَ بِأَصْحَابِ الْفِيلِ أَلَمْ يَجْعَلْ كَيْدَهُمْ فِي تَضْلِيلٍ وَأَرْسَلَ عَلَيْهِمْ طَيْرًا أَبَابِيلَ تَرْمِيهِمْ بِحِجَارَةٍ مِنْ سِجِّيلٍ فَجَعَلَهُمْ كَعَصْفٍ مَأْكُولٍ. A famous story of Abraha, the Ethiopian who tried to travel to Mecca with his elephants to destroy the Kaaba, which he was failed, and he was stopped in his tracks by the birds that threw stones, and these stones were these stones, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described them, أَلَمْ يَجْعَلْ كَيْدَهُمْ فِي تَضْلِيلٍ وَأَرْسَلَ عَلَيْهِمْ طَيْرًا أَبَابِيلَ تَرْمِيهِمْ بِحِجَارَةٍ مِنْ سِجِّيلٍ فَجَعَلَهُمْ كَعَصْفٍ مَأْكُولٍ. And so the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم was born during that year, the year of عام الفيل. نعم. Then he said that لَكِنَّمَا الْمَشْهُورُ ثَانِي عَشْرِهِ فِي يَوْمِ الْإِثْنَيْنِ طُلُوعَ فَجْرِهِ. That which is most famous from the statements of Ahl al-Ilm concerning the birth of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was that it was on the 12th of Dhul-Hijj, the 12th of Rabi' al-Awwal. It was the 12th of Rabi' al-Awwal, عام الفيل. So what they agree upon, number one, is عام الفيل. هذا بإجماع. There is إجماع that he was born in during the year عام الفيل. There's also يعني جمهارة أهل العلم, the majority of أهل العلم say that he was born in Rabi' al-Awwal. Rabi' al-Awwal. Although some say, a few say Rajab, but Rabi' al-Awwal is more correct. But they differed on the day in which he was born of Rabi' al-Awwal. Some say 8, some say 10, some say 12, some say 18, and so on and so forth. There are different aqwal concerning the specific date in which the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam he was born in. But we are also in ijma' that he was born on a Monday. There is also a consensus that he was born on a Monday, because the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said so in the hadith, that he was born on a Monday, and that is the reason why he fasts, as mentioned in the hadith, as-sahihah. طلوع فجره is a specific time which the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم was born of the day. He was born after Fajr, during the dawn period. عليه الصلاة والسلام. That's what this hadith, that's what this line is showing us. And so we find here that there is this great khilaf concerning the specific day in which he was born, shows to us that there is nothing shari'i, there is nothing specific related to the sharia concerning this specific date in which the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم was born in. Because had there been a shari'i related matter concerning the date of birth of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, then there would not have been this much khilaf. There would not have been this much khilaf. Now, then the author رحمه الله تعالى, he said, وَأَفَقَدْ عِشْرِينَ مِنْ نَيْسَانَ means he converted the date of birth from the Islamic lunar calendar to the Gregorian calendar. Refers to 20th of April. Nisan is the Arabic for April. And April, of course, is the fourth month of the Gregorian year. Then the Musannif رحمه الله تعالى, he says, وَقَبْلَهُ حَيْنُ أَبِيهِ حَانَ. حَيْنُ means the death. And so the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم was born a yatim. The Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم was born a yatim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, أَلَمْ يَجِدْكَ يَتِيمًا فَآوَى. In Surah Al-Duha, right? And so the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم lost his father whilst he was still in the womb of his mother. He was still in the womb of his mother when he lost his father. His father died coming back from Yathrib. Coming back from Yathrib. He was in Yathrib. And when he wanted to come back, he passed away in Yathrib with his uncles from Bani An-Najjar, the father of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, Abdullah ibn Abd al-Muttalib. And whether Abdullah ibn Abd al-Muttalib is in the fire or not is something that is discussed by the Ahlul Ilm. Some of Ahlul Ilm say that he's in the fire due to the hadith of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, أبوكَ وأبي في النار كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام, my father and your father are in the fire. And some ulama say that هذا الحديث لا, هذا الحديث يعني it doesn't refer to Abdullah specifically, and that Abdullah is considered from Ahlul Fatrah, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will test him. And whether he passes that test or not will depend on whether he enters into the hellfire or not. على كل حال, that is a topic which is from أمور الغيبية. We do not know whether he's from the hellfire or not. That is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فلا نخوض فيه. So we shouldn't enter ourselves into it or make such a big deal out of it like some people do. طيب. So here we learn from this man of poetry that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ولد يتيما. He came into this world without a father. He came into this world without a father. I, his father had passed away when he had come into this world. So the Messenger of Allah never met his father. Although he did have a father, he didn't ever meet him because he died whilst he was still in the womb of his mother. وَهَذَا أَبْلَغُ الدَّرَجَاتِ فِي الْيُتُمَ. This is the highest degree of orphanage because this person never ever met his father. Some people, some orphans, they meet their father. They live with their father for 8, 9 years or 10 years or 12 years. طيب. But the worst, or the most difficult form of orphanage is a person who his father passes away while he is still in the womb of his mother. So he comes out into the world without ever meeting, without ever having the chance to meet his father in this world. And so that's what we learn from these lines of poetry. And as we said, it will be the poem itself is a summarized seerah. It's a summarized outlook onto the life of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And so it's not upon us to make it a long sit, to go into deep explanation concerning the seerah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. We will leave that for other books بإذن الله, like رحيق المختوم بإذن الله تعالى. We go into much more detail. هذا والله أعلم. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك, أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت, أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.